Okay, the roll.
3-2. Joined by Assistant Sheriff Charles Hank, and we are talking about 1 October, 1 year later, and we do thank you, Assistant Sheriff, for being here and for your time.
Thank you for having me.
Lot to cover. Let's get right into it. Where do you feel a year after this tragic event we are as a community when you see the Vegas Strong, now Vegas Stronger hashtag, and some of the events in the community? Where do you feel we stand today?
Well, I think we stand at a good place. I think it's truly caused us to bring synergy, collaboration, and work closer together. I think the essence of Vegas Strong can be seen every day now. You know, when you look at the way the community responded, the way the sports teams, both the Knights as well as the Raiders who are coming, have come alongside us, encouraged those, not only our officers, but those in public safety to help us move forward and recover from this. So I think we're doing well. Our collaboration with our community partners, be it the fire, FBI, as well as the community support, is just continued to improve. So I think we've made a lot of progress. We've taken a negative and given us an opportunity to turn into something positive.
We so often focus on the community as we're talking about right now, but how are you as a department doing? How is morale as a department? We know officers that were such heroes that night have been impacted. How would you sum up the department 1 year later?
Well, I think it truly has impacted us. I think we're more vigilant. Mm-hmm. One of the, you know, back then and last year and even today, our vision was to be the safest community in America. And as you know, we became the location of one of the most deadly mass shootings in our nation's history. So it certainly has caused us to be more attentive, more vigilant, and also take our planning even more seriously. Very often we do tabletop exercises. We recently did an exercise, a multi-agency exercise at one of the high schools to deal with an active shooter type event. That too has taken more seriously. Oftentimes we look back and we say it's not a matter of if, but when. And now we look even closer to say it's not a matter of if, but do all we can to prevent it from occurring again, because we want to remain that safest community in America.
I have heard you in previous interviews talk about see something, say something, talk about team training, and talk about public awareness campaigns. What specifically can you tell Las Vegans that Las Vegas Metro Police is doing to make them safer? What are some of the changes in terms of team training and policy changes to make us safer now?
Well, first I'd like to talk about the see something,
sure,
say something. It's important that we not only say that, but live that. Mm-hmm. And to actually punctuate it a little bit more is we want the community to continue to be vigilant and be our partners, be our eyes out there so that they, when they do see something, they do say something. And what we mean by that is to not only look at what we call something that JDLR, just doesn't look right. Mm-hmm. If it doesn't look right, we encourage the community to call us. We don't want anyone to feel like they're crying wolf. We want to go out and resolve that issue and make sure there's not something of concern, because we don't want to have something that we've missed that we could have prevented. We've enhanced our training. We've brought along different tactics that we now do for mass gathering events. Mm-hmm. As you recall, last year, just a few weeks after this event, or 1 October, we had a marathon. So there we are putting 25,000 people right back on Las Vegas Boulevard and potentially exposing them. So we had to make sure that we took steps to make sure that event was safe, as well as the subsequent New Year's Eve event that had occurred, where we're bringing hundreds of thousands of people out there on the strip and potentially exposing them. So we took a lot of steps to get out there, increasing our officers for Overwatch. Mm-hmm. We now have added additional officers at large mass gathering events that have Overwatch. We now have dedicated strike teams and rifle deployments. Mm-hmm. So that if there was a threat, those officers are set aside and designated to take out that threat immediately.
And let's pick up there, those Overwatch teams, those dedicated strike teams. How safe are outdoor gatherings now? We just had Life is Beautiful recently, which went off very well. What is done differently at all of the outdoor venues? I think about the Golden Knights fans outside of T-Mobile Arena watching the game. Life is Beautiful, New Year's Eve. What is done now? Are those strike teams, those additional teams, those teams with long rifles, is that increasing safety enough at outdoor events, in your opinion?
I think that that truly has made some improvements and some enhancements. We also have brought on more undercover officers that are out there in plain clothes that are watching these events. There's more pre-planning and coordination with our security partners. We're working closely with, again, I mentioned with the fire department, as well as our federal partners that are working with us in pre-planning for these events. It's really important that the security partners, that they have enhanced their efforts as well, which many of them have. They've increased the number of security at the various events. Some have even added metal detectors, also added restrictions in terms of the type of bags or backpacks and things like that that are restricted. So I think we've made a lot of improvements, and I believe, as you saw from this past weekend with Life is Beautiful, we're a safe community and a safe place for folks to still come out and enjoy themselves.
With all of the releases to the public, we saw a plethora of heroic behavior by so many officers on that fateful night. We also saw officers maybe doing things we wouldn't have expected, the officer that kind of held up a floor below during the shooting. Are you looking at that and going, we did this really well, we did this very well, but also looking at those video releases that have been released to the public through legal requirement, do you look at some of that and go, this specifically is an area we could work on? Is that a part of the process?
Absolutely. We want to take a look at all of that and certainly learn from those mistakes or things that we can improve upon. As you mentioned, the video that came out about the particular officer, you were still looking at that to see exactly what point that he did what he did. Were shots still being fired? At that time, was he exposing himself to unnecessary jeopardy to go out? Certainly, as you mentioned, there were a lot of heroic efforts that were done on that night and still happen today, as if you've seen in many of the shootings that have happened over the past several weeks. Our officers still heroically run towards the gunfire. When someone starts shooting and causing harm, they're going. They're going to try to stop that threat and take that threat out. And so I'm very proud, very honored, as well as the sheriff. And I know the entire agency and command staff are proud of the work that officers do every day, as well as what they did on that night.
What is your personal recollection and remembrance of that night, and maybe one example of something where you were just so impressed by how a man or woman on Las Vegas Metropolitan Police reacted? What's something that you recall?
Well, I remember getting the call right away. At the time, I was a deputy chief, and I was over the tourist safety division, and the commander, then Captain Pelletier, called me that night and told me we had an active shooter event that was going on. One of the most memorable things for me is, as I've already alluded to, is just seeing the response. We had just about every officer in our agency get up as they heard what was going on and come on in. As you may have heard, there was a lot of what we call echo calls or calls that were coming out, that distraction calls where people thought there were other shooters. We thought we had a Mabai type situation, and thankfully not. But that went on for hours and until we finally knew for certain that there was only one shooter and one event. And so just to see the overall response from each and every officer on that night, I'm just very, very proud of each and every one of them.
So much communication that night, and of course there were communication challenges. Is there any way in a mass event like that, a mass tragedy, to have communication be as good as you would want it to be? What does Metro leadership do to prepare for possibly a future event where we need communication to be spot on?
Well, I think it worked very well, and part of that is our planning that we have in place in terms of dedicated radio channels, dedicated plans for people to do different things. It's the tabletops that we do. We do with the event planners. We also bring in the private security partners, our other public safety partners, both federal, even state. We work closely with NHP. So I think a lot of the pre-planning coordination that have went in place, and that we deal with so many major events already. We have NASCAR, mm-hmm. we have EDC, we have New Year's Eve, one of the largest event, west of from New York. We're one of the second largest event on New Year's Eve that occurs there. So we have a lot of experience, and overall things went well. But there's going to be chaos. There's going to be chaos in a situation like that if that were to occur. And it's important that people understand and realize that, to listen, to think about what part of what we also talk about, run, fight, and hide, to be a good witness, get out of the way. But also just have a plan, have some preparation as you go into different settings. Look around, look at the exits, and think about what you would do if something were to occur.
Sheriff Lombardo has previously talked about that, mentioning venues should have PSAs on how to safely exit, flee, survive some kind of attack. Expand on that. What exactly you would hope venues would do to make sure not only is the individual looking, how do I get out of a situation, but the venue is supporting that effort?
Well, I think a lot of them are doing that now. Mm-hmm. We leverage social media very often. Many of these events, just like this past weekend, Life is Beautiful, as well as Electric Daisy, they'll put up, they'll add an app, they'll have it where their folks that are attending can log in and get information and details about the itinerary and schedules of performers and things like that, and where to be and what time. And it's important that they take advantage of those opportunities to push that information there, to encourage people to use those platforms so that in the event of an emergency, we have the ability to directly reach out to those attendees immediately, because many of us, as you know, we carry smartphones. They've become a part of our life. The various social media platforms that are utilized are part of our lives. And so it's important that as event planners, as well as public safety, that we leverage those opportunities to be able to effectively communicate with people.
On that note, we talked in the weeks right after 1 October about hotels and casinos evaluating their security profiles. What is the follow-up on that? How are hotel casinos held responsible for knowing that their security profiles are dealing with this new world or preparing for this new world that we live in?
I believe they've made a tremendous amount of progress. Many of them are looking at various technologies that they could add. Some of them actually, if you come in and you check your bags, they're scanning the bags in the back. They still are concerned about that experience. People want to come, as we all know, as Americans, to enjoy ourselves and kind of escape. But we also don't want to ignore what has occurred and not take advantage of opportunities to do better. Some are involved, are adding metal detector type devices in the back of the house, so when folks check in their bags before they go up, they could be scanned. Some of them added security out front of their properties and near the elevators and things like that. So I think it's important that the properties continue to look for those opportunities to add those security enhancements without overwhelming their guests as they come in. But we can't ignore what occurred, and it's just finding that balance.
I want to talk about Charleston Hartfield. Talk about how the Metro family has honored his memory with the Southern Nevada Law Enforcement Memorial. He, of course, was there at the concert and was killed at the concert off duty. Talk about how his memory is honored by the Metro family.
Well, we realize that's the ultimate sacrifice, mm-hmm. and not to dismiss the other 58 lives, they're just as important. But when it's one of your own and one of your personal family's members as a law enforcement officer, we see them as family. It hurts, and it hurts to see every victim of that was lost their lives as well as that were injured on that day. It is a little bit more because Charleston being an officer and losing his life on that day, it's something that he will always be remembered. He's there on our wall of fallen officers to remind us of one of our fellow brothers has made that ultimate sacrifice. So it's with honor, it's with the utmost respect and appreciation for the sacrifice that he made.
And as we honor Officer Hartfield and all the others that lost their lives on October 1st, 2018, how do you want the public, how would you like them to honor this tragedy and to honor the lives lost? What do you expect of the public or hope from them?
Well, I think it's my hope that we could continue to not only mourn, but take the opportunity to reflect and then think about what we could do better, how we could get closer, how we could continue to break down those walls, how we could continue to collaborate, how we could take advantage of not only the saying, see something, say something, but what part that they individually can play in terms of making a difference to help prevent something like that from occurring. But I think it's also important that we remember those that we lost, as well as those that were injured on that day. And just reflect on that and think about it and think about the positive contributions that they made to our community and be grateful for that and just look for opportunities to do better.
And as we wrap up here, this is, of course, a national story and has been since it happened. When you talk to people in other cities around the country or around the world and they ask about this event, how do you think it has impacted you personally when you look back 1 year later? We know what you were doing that night, but as you look back, we know the impact on the department. How about the impact on you?
Well, you mentioned about talking to around the country. We've received a number of invites to come out and share. Not to boast about only what we did right, because we did do a lot of things right, but also look at those lessons learned, what we could do better. And it's important that we share that, and it's tough, because in law enforcement, and most times as we deal with tragedy, and I can imagine even in your setting, a lot of news is negative, you wind up compartmentalizing that and you set it aside. And now you have to go relive it and share. But it's important that we do that, because a record was set that day that we don't want to see broken. Not that one we're proud of, but we know if it were to occur again, there'll be additional loss of life. So if we could do anything to help another community prevent it, as well as be better prepared to respond to it and or mitigate that from occurring, we want them to learn from what we could have done better. But for me personally, again, one of the biggest things for me is just the honor of being a member of our agency and to look and reflect on what our officers did on that day, as well as all the other members of our community to see us come together. You know, we often say Las Vegas is very transient, and I think it was truly reflected there that we truly are a family, and we continue and will continue to be resilient and continue to be Vegas strong.
We in the media, of course, saw all those videos of so much heroism, so many people heading towards the danger. And so we at 8 News Now thank the men and women of Metro Police for all you did that night and beyond. And we also thank you, Assistant Sheriff Charles Hank. Thanks for your time.
Sir. Thank you, Brian.
Appreciate it. And this entire interview can be seen on our website, www.lasvegasnow.com.